Hi, my name is Adrián del Río, and in this speech I'm going to talk about the role that renormalization theory of quantum fields plays when considering a curved spacetime. We'll present its formalism and then some applications in cosmology. Well, we have divided the lecture into three different parts. Firstly, I will briefly review the subject of QFT in curved spacetime, just explaining the standard formalism and giving some emphasis on the difference with respect to the case in Minkowski. Then this will lead us to consider physical quantities that are defined locally, such as the stress energy tensor. Immediately after, I will introduce the necessity of defining new ways of regularizing these physical quantities, since they diverge in the ultraviolet regime. I will present two methods, the so-called adiabatic and de Wittgenstein renormalization schemes. And well, today I will just confine myself to the Klein-Gordon case only. Maybe in a later seminar we can discuss the formalism for higher spin fields. Finally, just to show the power of these techniques, I will present an application to cosmology and renormalize the standard observable for inflation, the angular power spectrum. So, the subject of QFT in curved spacetime is basically the study of the behavior of quantum fields propagating in a classical gravitational field. It is used to analyze phenomena where the quantum nature of fields and the effects of gravitation are both important. But here, the quantum nature of gravity itself is assumed not to play a crucial role, so that gravitation can be described by a classical curved spacetime, just as in the framework of general relativity. Among the most celebrated results of this theory is the well-renowned stimulated or spontaneous creation of particles due to the gravitational dynamics. So let's start with considering a generic free field in a smooth four-dimensional globally hyperbolic manifold with a Lorentzian metric. The dynamics of the field, in other words, the equation of motion, is given by the variational principle of some action. This action of the field theory is constructed from the field so that it is invariant under general coordinate transformations. And well, the simplest way to achieve that is taking the so-called minimal coupling prescription, which consists in doing the following substitutions. Partial derivatives are changed to covariant ones, which consider either the spin connection or the spin array connection, etc. Then the Minkowskian metric is substituted by the metric of spacetime, and so on and so forth. Some examples of equation of motion are shown on the slide. For instance, the covariant Klein-Gordon equation reads this as it is shown on the slide, while the covariant Dirac equation is shown on the slide as well. The thing is that given the equation of motion of the field, with any two solutions, one can define an inner product like this, with sigma taken as a Cauchy surface. And with the definition of the scalar product, one can always select a complete set of conjugate solutions satisfying orthonormality conditions. And then the formal solution of the field can then be expressed as a linear combination of one of these complete set of solutions. The quantization now in curved spacetime follows in close analogy to the Minkowski space case. The field theory is quantized in the canonical quantization scheme by treating the field as an operator and imposing some equal time commutation relations between the field and its conjugate momentum. These are equivalent to the explicitly covariant commutation relations for the so-called creation and regulation operators. And then this algebra serves to construct a focus space by defining a vacuum state following this rule. So at this point, a natural question arises. We actually have, as we said, an infinite number of solutions for the field modes, and this is eventually translated to an ambiguity in the choice of the vacuum state. The question then is, which vacuum state should I consider to describe the physics of a certain system? Well, in Minkowski, there is a natural answer to this. There is a natural set of models given by the Poincaré group. The Minkowski line element remains invariant under the action of this group of symmetries. So one can just take advantage of this maximal set of Killing vectors generated in the Lie algebra to choose our model solutions to be eigenfunctions of these Killing vectors. This provides a natural vacuum state for Minkowski, which in physical grounds means that all inertial observers would agree in its chosen vacuum. So that's easy for Minkowski, but however, in closed spacetime, the Poincaré group is no longer a symmetry group of the spacetime, and indeed, in general, there will be no Killing vectors with which to define the modes. As a consequence, no natural decomposition of the field in terms of the modes will be. There's no unique solution for the vacuum state. This is the general conclusion that we extract from this. It is necessary to some input, some additional physics, to point out a particular choice for the mode solutions and consequently for the vacuum state. So if this is true, we can now consider a second complete orthonormal set of modes in which we expand the field. This decomposition defines a new vacuum state given by this expression and a new focus space. So as both sets are complete, we are ensured to find an expansion of the new modes in terms of the old ones. Imposing both expansions of the field to be equivalent, we can just find the so-called Bogoliubov transformations which relate the old and the new bases. It follows from this, from the expression of the annihilation operator in terms of the old bases, that the two focus spaces based on these two choices will be different as long as the parameter beta is not null, because otherwise we will have both annihilation operators to be proportional to each other, and they will define the same vacuum state. So as long as the beta parameter is different from zero, we will have different two focus spaces. So a particular consequence is that the expectation value of the number operator for a given choice, but evaluated in the opposite vacuum state, will remain at a different value from zero. So this shows that the definition of particles is actually a very observer-dependent concept. And this idea is basically the mechanism upon which particles are produced in a gravitational background. The so-called Parker, Hawking, or Unruh effects, and these kind of effects are a consequence of this fact. So the reason for this ambiguity of the particle concept comes from its global nature in terms of the modes. The modes are defined in the whole spacetime. In contrast, physical detectors are quasi-local in nature. Therefore, it seems worthwhile to investigate physical quantities that are defined locally, such as the stress energy tensor. This objective, an objective concept, because in the sense that the results of different measuring devices, different observers, can be related by the usual tensor transformation, in contrast to the particle concept. And also, it acts as a source of gravity in the semiclassical Einstein field equations, so plays an important role in the power creation problem. The point is that, as it happens in Minkowski, the stress energy tensor has ultraviolet divergences. In Minkowski, the so-called normal ordering is employed to sketch this drawback. But however, now, in current spacetime, as we will see, additional ultraviolet divergences will appear. And what's more, here any vacuum energy contributes to the total gravitational field, so it cannot be simply discarded. New methods must be studied to solve this problem. We start by describing the method called adiabatic renormalization.
as applied to the free scalar field in a Friedmann, Lemaître, Robertson, Walker spacetime. This particular case follows naturally from the basis we have already built, also provides a clear understanding of some of the physical issues important in this theory, and furthermore allows us to lead easily to more general approaches later. So we will consider the most general equation of motion shown on the slide for the Klein-Gordon equation, the first equation, and it will be propagated in a curved spacetime described by this line element for the metric, the second equation. So now choose any complete set of orthonormal solutions of the field equations and expand the field in them, as it is shown on the slide. Take now this ansatz for the field modes, given on the right-hand side, which is motivated by the spatial symmetries, and we remain all the information in the temporal dependence of the modes. Now, put this into the Klein-Gordon equation and get a second-order differential equation for the field modes, as it is shown down here. From this equation we can see an important fact, and it is the following. If we take the limit for large momentum of the field modes with respect to the rate of expansion of the universe, then in this case the omega with respect to sigma, then the equation of motion asymptotically reduces to that one in Minkowski space, so recovering the Minkowski mode solutions. This is crucial in establishing the so-called adiabatic condition. In the limit that the rate of expansion of the universe is sufficiently slow in contrast to the frequency of the field modes, then the Minkowski modes should be recovered. Let's therefore rely on the known solution in Minkowski to take this answer for the asymptotic structure of the field modes in a general cosmological background. The question now resides in determining this function, W, and for that purpose we introduce it in the equation of motion and solve by iteration. Just expand this function in a series in which each of the terms has a definite number of derivatives of the scale factor, adiabatic order we will call it, and we shall take this as a measure of how adiabatic our function is. And finally, to ensure that we recover the Minkowski solutions in the strict adiabatic limit, we impose these initial conditions for the frequency, that the zeroth order contribution must be that one of Minkowski, the frequency in Minkowski. So, before going on with this analysis, it's important to stress some remarks. Firstly, just to say that from the initial condition on the frequency, what we will call as the zeroth adiabatic order contribution, one can determine univocally the rest adiabatic orders just by solving by iteration the previous equation. However, the sum of tau v is not guaranteed to be convergent. It is just an asymptotic series. That's important. And the reason for that is that the adiabatic solution is just an asymptotic solution for the field modes. The general solution has in general an additional contribution which is not perturbative asymptotically. What is important of the adiabatic series is that it is unique. It comes from geometrical contribution for the back of the background to the field modes. It is geometrical and unique, and the ambiguity of the vacuum state discussed before is contained here in the non-perturbative solution for the equation of motion. Therefore, every solution of the equation of motion possesses the same adiabatic or asymptotical development. As we shall see, this is precisely what allows the possibility of renormalization, because all ultraviolet divergences will share this behavior. So, in adiabatic renormalization, the physically relevant finite expression is obtained from the formal one containing ultraviolet divergences by subtracting mode by mode each term in the adiabatic expansion of the integrand that contains at least one ultraviolet divergent part for arbitrary values or the parameters of the theory, in our case, in the scalar case, the coupling constant and the mass. To give an example, let's compute the vacuum expectation value of the two-point function at coincidence. Using the field decomposition into modes, one can obtain this expression. This is formally ultraviolet divergent. We can take the large momentum limit to analyze in detail this, since we know it is universal for every solution of the equation of motion. And taking into account this general behavior, which holds for every adiabatic order contribution, then we can clearly see that in this case, in this observable, two different divergences appear. So according to the adiabatic scheme, we must subtract up to second adiabatic order, and the result is consequently finite by construction. This is the way the method works. As a second application of adiabatic regularization, we shall compute the stress of the stress energy tensor. The general expression for a Klein-Gordon field is rather long and complicated, and for practical purposes, let us consider just the simple case of T equal to 1 over 6. In this case, stress reduces to the simple expression, to this one shown on the slide. And if one analyzes in detail each of the individual components of the stress energy tensor, one finds that it is necessary actually to go up to fourth adiabatic order to yield a finite quantity in this case, in contrast to the two-point function. So the thing is that doing all the computation properly, one can obtain a physical quantity like this. And from this, we can also extract an interesting feature. And it is, it appears when studying the conformally invariant field. If we take the limit of zero mass, a conformal field, one gets a remand in the renormalized trace of the stress energy tensor. This is the well-known conformal or Weyl trace anomaly. This anomaly arises from the subtractions, which were necessary to arrive at the finite physical expectation value of the components of the stress energy tensor. This will be of certain importance at the end of the speech, because we will find in cosmology a certain analogy. These kind of anomalies appear very often in quantum field theory and cross space time. So it is important to take it in mind. So the thing is, once we have studied the adiabatic method in detail, it is illustrative to go further and work out other schemes that are valid in a general space time. Consider now a Klein-Gordon field providing a general background with line element shown on the slide, totally general. And the analog of the adiabatic condition can now be specified in the Green function defined by this equation shown on the slide. The leading order contribution in the ultraviolet limit would give this formula for the Green function, with sigma being the proper distance along the geodesic joining the two points. Higher order contributions can be obtained by iteration from a set of coupled differential equations. And the result has been calculated using techniques from differential geometry and can be written at the end of the day with a series defined by this F function. The first order contributions at coincidence are shown on the slide, which will be relevant for subtracting the ultraviolet divergences. This is the so-called, this formalism, the so-called Debye Schwinger or proper time formalism. And the leading terms in this asymptotic expansion give a generally covariant way of expressing the divergent terms that appear in the expectation values of products of quantum fields at a single space-time points, as we saw for the two-point function or the stress energy tensor. So in this case, this method, divergences at s equal to zero correspond to the short distance ultraviolet divergences, since they take place when we take the coincidence limit. Following in close analogy to the adiabatic method that we have discussed, one can just work out the corresponding renormalized observables, such as the two-point function or the trace anomaly or the trace of the stress energy tensor, and basically obtains the same thing. So, well, up to now, we have only discussed how to obtain finite quantities from formal divergent ones. It's necessary to replace these formal divergent contributions somewhere else in our theory. We can manage to do this actually by working with the Lagrangian formalism. Using path integral quantization, it is possible to show that the effective action for the quantum field in this gravitational background can be written in terms of the Green function, as it is shown in the first equation. And, well, as the ultraviolet divergences are common to every quantum field theory, we can simply consider the asymptotic adiabatic structure of the Green function using the Wittes-Winger formalism. And, well, one will obtain this second formula. And then at the end of the day, the Lagrangian can be expressed this way. In order to regularize the divergence, it is useful to employ the so-called dimensional regularization. And doing so and taking the constant limit, we get this final formula, which is important in the following. From this sum, we find from the gamma function and this sum, we find three different ultraviolet divergences. The divergent part of the Lagrangian has this general behavior where A, B, C are dimensionless constants. And if you remember the explicit expression for the Wittes-Winger coefficients, you will immediately realize that this is basically a purely geometrical Lagrangian. We are able to absorb then the divergences in the gravitational Lagrangian. The zero order contribution, zero derivatives in the metric of the metric, renormalizes the cosmological constant term. Then the second order contributions can be absorbed in the Newton's gravitational constants, so providing a finite quantity. And finally, the second derivative coefficient contains four derivatives of the metric and must be absorbed properly. The thing is that the standard Einstein gravitational field equation do not contain such terms, but in order to absorb this divergence, we need such contribution. So we may say that renormalization predicts that there should be a fourth order contribution to the Einstein equation. New gravitational physics or new phenomenology. It may happen that this is negligible in the context where general relativity has been tested or whatever. But the thing is that renormalization predicts up to the fourth order in derivatives of the metric contributions to the Einstein's field equations. So we see from here that renormalization is a very powerful and predictive theory, especially when considering a crude spacetime as well. Well, as we said before, one of the most important applications of QFT in crude spacetime is the early universe, inflation. The inflationary theory basically claims that at the very beginning of the evolution of the universe, a nearly exponential expansion of the space took place. To describe such a scenario, the flat, homogeneous, and isotropic Friedmann-Robertson-Walker metric is considered with an exponentially growing scaling factor. The inflationary stage was improved by many authors, and the conclusion was that inflation can be generally driven by this potential, but the potential of a certain scalar field, which dominates the total energy density of the universe at that time. Well, an illustrative example is shown on the slide, on the picture, and we see that the potential is flat, therefore it acts as a source of nearly constant vacuum energy, leading this way to an early exponential expansion with nearly constant rate. The field is said to slowly roll down the potential, and it is this slight motion what drives the period of inflation. In this process, vacuum energy and hence the rate of expansion H decay gradually with time, and this decay is described by the so-called slow roll parameters, epsilon and delta. Well, this scalar field responsible for the stage of inflation is supposed to have a quantum nature. Therefore, we are naturally led to the problem of studying a quantum field theory in a cosmological scenario. particles perturbation of the stress energy tensor are likely to be produced during our slow rolling fluorescent expansion. And indeed, this mechanism of spontaneous gravitational particle production during inflation is regarded as to be the responsible for the origin of the primordial cosmological fluctuations. Quantum perturbations of the field would be responsible for the little homogeneities in the primordial matter density just after inflation, at the beginning of the standard adiabatic expansion, that eventually gave rise to the large-scale structure of the universe and the anisotropies in the CMB temperature. The standard observable supporting inflation is the so-called angular power spectrum, which is represented in the right picture. Observations agree in the theoretical prediction of this quantity by standard computation of QFT. So in the rest of this speech, we will basically discuss this quantity and specifically its renormalization, which is something that we have worked out recently in the literature. Work out the primordial cosmological fluctuations, we need to study simultaneously both scalar perturbations of the field and the metric. And a suitable magnitude encoding both scalar quantities and which is gauge invariant is the so-called commoving curvature perturbation. It can be treated as a scalar field and its quantum modes become independent of time once they cross the Hubble horizon. This is a very important feature during inflation because this provides an initial condition for the subsequent evolution of the primordial perturbations once inflation ends and once these fluctuations re-enter the horizon scale in the recent history of the universe upon which we have direct observables. So they imprint the information of inflation in the recent observables in cosmology. So an excellent feature of this is that the power spectrum, one can just expand in Fourier modes. Well, the modes can be studied through the so-called power spectrum defined this way. And the thing is that it is nearly scale invariant, almost independent of the scale K. So this is the results obtained via the momentum picture of inflation. Our job is now to try to reproduce all this information in the space-time viewpoint. And apart from this, we will see that divergences appear very easily and, well, are seen very easily, and we will just try to subtract them by adiabatic renormalization. So, scalar perturbations, as we said, can be studied through a quantum scalar field in a slow roll scenario. We can just decompose this field into modes and solve the corresponding equation of motion with the choice of the so-called Banks-Davis vacuum. Having this particular vacuum state and the explicit form of the scalar modes solving the equation of motion, we can just compute the two-point function. And the result is shown on the slide, written in terms of the hypergeometric function. Well, at this point, one would like to get an analog result to that one of the momentum picture in which modes get frozen, they get independent of time once they cross the horizon scale. So for that purpose, we analyze the large scale behavior of this correlator. We consider the limit at which the two points are much more separated than the horizon scale, and we get this leading contribution to the scalar amplitude. From this, we see that the scalar amplitude is nearly scale invariant, almost independent of the two-point distance, and also, moreover, we see that this time independent, totally time independent, which allows to introduce a particular definition of time and rearrange this result in terms of the, well, just as it is shown on the slide. And this is a very similar expression if one works out the corresponding analog, the power spectrum in the momentum picture. So we recover the same result in the analog space, in the space-time viewpoint. But the thing is that the information that we precisely extract from observations comes from the angular power spectrum. And to derive it, let's consider the leading contribution to the scalar two-point function, the large-scale behavior, as we said. We will restrict the two-point function to points located at the last scattering surface of the photons of the CMB. And the distance of the points from us is given by the Kumomi radial coordinate to this surface. Both points define as well two directions that yield an angular separation, which will be described by this parameter, theta. So with all of this, the angular power spectrum can be computed using this expression in terms of the scalar amplitude. And the two-point function can be related to temporal fluctuations trivially using the Sachs-Wolf effect. Doing all the calculation properly, one eventually gets to this expression, which recovers identically the standard value obtained via the power spectrum using the model representation of the fluctuation fields. So for the moment, with the space-time framework, we recover the standard and well-known prediction of inflationary cosmology in a very elegant way. But apart from that, we will be able to see additional implications of this viewpoint. We shall take advantage of this space-time viewpoint to analyze further implications of this observable. We notice that the standard result is obtained taking into account only the large-scale behavior of the two-point function. But actually, there is an additional contribution to the correlator due to short distances. In this space-time framework, we are able to see this very easily because of how you manage to solve the equations in contrast to the momentum picture. But we note that if the angular power spectrum were actually evaluated using the total scalar amplitude, then the integral would have been divergent to this integral of the angular power spectrum would be divergent due to the quadratic ultraviolet divergence as spatial points merge. The use of the large distance behavior everywhere in the integral bypasses the ultraviolet divergence and makes the integral convergent. Note that initially, we only consider this contribution because it is the dominant term in the two-point function for large scales. But as time evolves during inflation, physical distances grow exponentially, and it is reasonable to think that only large scales are important. However, for a finite expansion, there is always a regime in which the short distances behavior actually dominates the two-point function, and hence the contribution to the integral. So how this must be computed properly? Since we are actually dealing with a quantum field theory, it seems natural to proceed with the normalization of this observable. For a cosmological setting, the most suitable technique is the point-splitting version of aortic regularization. This procedure provides the typical quadratic and logarithmic divergences of a QFT in closed space for a two-point function, and particularly we find the exact divergence that we have in our observable. The two-point function can therefore be naturally renormalized by subtracting this expression. So the final renormalized version for the angular power spectrum is presented on the slide. We basically record the previous result plus a correction. And this correction is scale invariant as well. So there is no apparent tension with observations. Depending on its value, it may reduce or not significantly the amplitude of temperature fluctuations. So, another remark on this result is the following fact. This expression provides zero to the angular power spectrum in the limit of recovering perfect De Sitter spacetime. This result is justified in the sense that within the context of a maximally symmetric space, no particle production is expected to happen. And consequently, no cosmological fluctuations or eventually temperature anisotropies would be detected. And well, some other implications, but let's end up with the conclusions. Just to say that renormalization is a highly predictive theory that allows to find new phenomenology when a cross space is considered. As we have discussed in many ways during the speech, trace anomaly, gravitational Lagrangian, inflation, and so on and so forth. Cosmology, in particular, is a very suitable scenario since in recent years, lots of experimental results are available. Moreover, new features arise if one goes to higher spin fields, such, for instance, the chiral symmetry breaking for Dirac fields or the electric magnetic duality for spin 1 fields for photons. And, well, just end saying that adiabatic actually is a representative of, is equivalent to the Wittes-Finger method, but very suitable for cosmology. It's a more powerful technique, although it is only limited to cosmology, but just to say that they are both equivalent. And well, this is the end of the speech. Thank you for your attention.